In this video lecture, we'll start looking at how to use arrays as data or instance variables in larger classes. Okay, let's get started. We've already seen how to handle core data types and objects such as strings or CS12 dates as data or instance variables in classes. Well, arrays are nothing but another type of data that can be used in any Java class. Arrays can be used as data in classes, either as the local variables inside any method or as the instance variables of some class. Arrays can also be the inputs or outputs of any method. For example, we might need to pass an array into some method of a class using a mutator or a constructor. We might need to return an array from some method of the class, such as when using an accessor. Or within the confines of a class, we might simply need to pass arrays in and out of methods to better structure our code internally. Let's start by looking at arrays as local variables. We can declare and use arrays within any method, just like any other variable. We've already seen how to declare and instantiate arrays in prior materials. Now, an array is no different from any other variable in that it has local scope within its method, and it disappears as soon as that method is exited. In this simple example on the right, inside this method called doSomething, we declare and instantiate this integer array of high temperatures, then initialize its values by some means. But as soon as we exit this method, this array disappears because it has local scope inside this method. Let's start thinking in terms of some class which is centered around using an array as an instance variable. For the coming discussions, let's focus on an array of ints, but most everything we'll be discussing can easily be generalized to a class based upon an array of objects, such as an array of person objects. This diagram will be central to our understanding of an array-based class. Here, we have an array called data, and we have this array reference pointing to this array of elements located elsewhere in memory. So this array itself is one of our instance variables. We also have this companion instance variable count, which is our other instance variable. The count variable stores the current number of elements in our array, and it also conveniently doubles as the location of the next available array element. So our next data element would be placed into data subcount, as we see here. By the way, notice that, so far, all of this is completely generic. We haven't yet specified any data types for these array elements. We've said that this will be an array of ints, but it just as well could be an array of doubles or an array of persons. Then, the methods of our class are all the things we can do to our array. Typical things we want to know or do are: what's the max size of this array? How many elements are actually being used? How would we print all the elements of this array, which involves looping through only the used portion of the array? How can we add elements to the end, or the unused portion of, the array? How do we get or set individual array elements, after first checking that some specified index is valid? And how might we perform certain actions upon specific elements of the array? As we progress through all of the following examples, note that they can all be found in the example file array1dints class.java, found in the usual place. I would strongly encourage you to follow along in that file in JGrasp and view its associated code walkthrough video as needed. First off, here's what our array instance variables might look like. In this code example, this int array called data is declared only. We may or may not know its intended size at this point, but we'll deal with that later in its constructors. Like any other instance variables, this array has class scope, which means it will be globally visible to all of its methods, which will be used to manipulate this array. Also, we'll declare this count variable so we can explicitly keep track of how many array elements are actually in use. Finally, just like always, both these instance variables are declared to be private to this class. Next, here are three different overloaded constructors for our array class, and as they should be, all these are declared as public. This top one is the default constructor. It accepts no inputs and internally instantiates the declared instance variable array, data, to some default size, whose constant we've established upstream somewhere in this file. The declaration states that we will have this many ints by default, and so now we have a workable array of that size. We also initialize our count variable to 0. This second constructor allows us to explicitly size our array. It's similar to the previous one, except we now size the array to the commanded value, and as before, initialize the count variable to 0. This third constructor lets us accept some outside array for sizing and initialization. Note that the data type of this input argument is an integer array, with these square brackets, not simply an int. We start off by instantiating our instance variable array to be of the same size as the input array. We also assume that the input array is filled with specific values, so we initialize the count to be that length. Then, in this for loop, all we're doing is an element-by-element transfer of data from the input array to the instance variable array. Both these last two constructor forms are nice because they allow us to dynamically size our instance variable array, either to a specific size or using some other existing array. Since we're going to be keeping track of the used portion of the array ourselves, we'll need to provide these three simple size utilities, which will be used throughout the later methods we'll be creating. In general, we want to know these three simple things: how much total space do we have, how much of that space is currently being used, and is there any room to add more array elements? These three methods on the right answer those questions. GetMaxSize returns the usual array length, GetUseSize returns the current count of used elements, and isRoom returns the Boolean status of whether the actual use size is less than the maximum possible size. All of these are nice, simple, uniformly named method wrappers around some simple data that will be needed over and over again in our other class methods. If we're going to be manipulating individual array elements by their index, there will be two things we'll need: if some given index is or is not within the used region of the array, and some sort of checking that we're providing only valid index values. This top method on the right, isValidIndex, accepts an integer index value and returns a Boolean status as to whether that index is legitimate. It does this by going through this sequence of checks. First, we check that the index isn't less than 0. Next, we check if the current element count is 0, in which case there are no valid index values. Then, as long as the index is less than the count, the index is valid. Whatever the resulting status, it's returned to the caller as a Boolean true-false value for some decision-making. This other method, promptValidIndex, can be used whenever we need to prompt the user for an index at the command line, but we want to ensure that index is valid. In this else branch, we prompt the user to enter an index, and we follow that by printing out all the current legitimate data values and their indices for selection. Once the user has entered some index value, this while loop at the end will keep dogging the user until they enter some legitimate value, and we use the prior method to determine that. When all is said and done, this method will ensure that any index the user enters is a valid one, or else a -1 index will be returned if there is no valid index to be had. We're also going to need some display methods for our array-based class. We know that it's a standard programming convention to always provide some class-specific toString method. So in this code at the right, we'll simply construct a comma-separated list of all the array elements using this loop. We start off with this temp string containing the first element, then notice that we loop from 1, not 0, through the balance of the array to construct this string, and then return it to the caller. For the print method, we'll elect to print some status type information about the array, using our three available size utilities. Then, we'll also go through this loop and print each element's index and value. Then, just as we did for the person class, we'll also provide this overloaded print method, which allows us to print this formatted header ahead of the usual print information. We've also got this additional separator utility down here at the end, and what this lets us do is print some specified separator character some fixed number of times. And notice that this is a private method to the class. But going back up to the preceding overloaded print method, we use the separator method before and after the message to print some desired character, perhaps a hyphen or an asterisk, as many times as the message is long, plus some extra overhang amount. We've got both the default separator character and the overhang declared as constants up at the head of this file somewhere. Again, please take a look at the example file array1dints.class.java in its code walkthrough for more details on all these methods and to see them execute. We'll end here and continue on with the other half of this lecture video.